Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Come on now, you better than that. Praise the Lord. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. God is a good God. There is nobody like our Father. There's nobody like Jesus. How many people love him? How many love Jesus in the house today? I don't want to too much. Come on now. Somebody give God a shout. Just shout it out. Just give him. Like we had a Sixers game. Now we can say that now. We had a Sixers game. We can celebrate it. An Eagle game. We had an Eagle game. Look at that. Hallelujah. I am so glad our family talked about being back home and having their foundation here. Now, y'all know I got my foundation right here. And so I haven't spoken in more than a year, actually. When I looked at my notes, it's been more than a year. And certainly it's been more than a year for a youth Sunday. So this is like, talk about homecoming. This is amazing. We should have had a reunion, y'all. But anyway. But I am just so happy to be before you. I was going to ask Pastor, because I was getting antsy, because I hadn't spoken in a long time. And I was going to ask Pastor if I could speak, and before I got a chance to get to him, he said he already sent me a text message asking me to speak. So I know we're in the spirit. So I know I'm where I'm supposed to be.
Amen.
Now, y'all know that I couldn't get out of this sermon today without telling at least one little story about the kids. Y'all know I couldn't just, I don't know what it has to do with the message, but I just got to tell. So we were in the car, going home. I picked the two little girls up from school, and they were a little disappointed that something did not happen. They were a little disappointed, and if something didn't happen that one of them wanted to happen desperately, and she was just sad, and she just couldn't take it. And I said, this was my moment, it's my opportunity. I take those lessons, those times. And I said, well, sweetheart, when we get disappointed, what we can do is we can pray. And we can pray that God will either change what we're disappointed about so we don't have to be disappointed, or change how we feel so that we will see it differently so then we won't be disappointed either. I thought that was good father talk. That's a good moment lesson right there. I was doing good. And then she said, well, Daddy, boys don't know God. Now, you gotta understand, she's 5 years old, so things that kind of threw me off. I was like, where did this come from? I thought I could give you a good lesson. She said, boys don't know God. What she meant was, I didn't know God. Being a male, she didn't say man on there. She said, Grammy, who was her grandmother, we call her Grammy, knows God. She was trying to say, you're trying to tell me about God. Now I know Grammy knows God. Matter of fact, she went on to say that Grammy knows God better than anyone in the world. And I was intrigued. I said, well, how do you know that Grammy knows God better than anyone in the world? And she said, I was rolling, y'all. She said, I know Grammy knows God because she's old. Don't you know all old people know God? So, High Street, I just want to congratulate you because I heard that there were some seasoned saints up in the building. And so, if you didn't know it, if you old, then you know God, so you ain't got to worry about this one. I called her grandmother and told her that, and she said she was just speechless. That might be actually a good segue into what we want to talk about, because the scriptures are old, they are ancient, and we're going to learn from the scriptures this morning. If you wouldn't mind turning with me to Hebrews 4, it's kind of way up there at the top, Hebrews 4, 14 to 16. And when you get it, say, I got it, and we'll read it together. Y'all got it? Say amen.
Amen.
Yes. to go look into my little get there. Hebrews, we old. Y'all ain't that old, man. And the pastor, don't call me doctor or anything, by the way. Just call me whatever y'all was calling me before, because y'all up in here, some of y'all done changed my diaper, some of y'all taught me Sunday school, I've been running around here messing up the church, and I can't, it don't sound right. When I get to school, they can call me that, you know, later on, but Jesus, the great high priest, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14. Y'all got it?
Amen.
All right, read it with me. Therefore, since we have such a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to what we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses. But we have one who is tempted in every way that we are, yet was without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. I'm going to pray and get started. Father, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for being able to look into your word and learn about you. And we especially thank you for this particular passage, this part of your word. And we pray that it would speak to us. That you would, as it were, put a kind of a target right on us as individuals and help us to understand what you are trying to say. I pray that you would help me to be able to express it very clearly so we would all, my brother prayed, leave differently than we can. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So, I have been studying a lot about trauma in my program and in what I do full-time. I've been working with people for the last 7 years or so who have been through what I now call, what I now know is trauma. I didn't always know what to call it, how to understand it. But I work with people who have been through what we call trauma. And I have to admit that over the past several months, I have been dealing with my own questions, very deep questions, about my own where I am with God. And I'm going to be very vulnerable with you in this message. I've had the kind of questions that have had to do with what happened to me based on what my family experienced when we were younger. I'm 44. And, my father was an alcoholic, and he abused drugs for about 40 years. That was Maurice Eshon. And that's not all he was, because you, on the one hand, you might say, he was the most intelligent man you ever met. Matter of fact, my mother said that about him. He's the most intelligent man I ever met, she said. But at the same time, when he would get drunk, he would become a whole other person. He was like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. And so he would transform into into a verbally abusive, emotionally abusive, physically abusive. Fortunately, he never actually was in the habit of abusing physically me and my brother. Although, when we got spankings, you would think. But that wasn't really abuse, that was just we getting spankings. That's another story. I've been wondering as of late, based on what I've been learning, what happened to me as a result of what we went through in that household. Yes. I remember the house just shaking sometimes. It would just, when things would go down in that house, it would just, the whole house would quake. And I had migraines when I was a kid, and I grew out of it. Interestingly enough, when we moved out of the house and went to grandma. And so, the stuff has been resurfacing because I can vividly remember pictures in my mind of what it was like to be involved. I'm not trying to get into too many details, I know some kids in here, but it just I saw too much. Now, I know that you know people who are like that. You know a lot of people are like that. I work with them at my school. My students are women who are African-American women. They are 28, 29, 30 to 45. They come from the hood. They come from situations of poverty. And they have been through the most difficult circumstances that you can imagine. These people are the most amazingly persistent people you can ever imagine. It's amazing what these women have been through and what they accomplished just to get their first college degree. It is amazing that they could actually focus with all that they've been through, and yet at the same time, I see how they react to them. And I see what goes on with them, and they divulge things sometimes to us, and they have in the years, and over the years, I teach the first course that they take when they come into the associate's program at our school. And the first paper that they write, their first assignment is to write a description of four different life experiences that they have learned from. And they describe those experiences, and they describe how those experiences shape their self-understanding. What do you understand about yourself based on those experiences? Now, I never ask my students to tell me their deepest, darkest, most hideous experiences, but invariably I get a paper that I read, and I'm just like, I don't even know how to grade this. How can I had students who have been, it takes me right back to my childhood. And then there's some stuff that I can't even imagine how people could go through what some of these people go through. Now, y'all know people like that. They're in this neighborhood. They're in every neighborhood. They're all over. And our pastor has been, for the years that I've been here, encouraging us, shaping us, molding us. You do know that Ephesians 4 calls us all ministers. He gave us pastors and preachers and teachers, but later on in that very same set of verses, it says that the ministers, those of us who are hearing and understanding what we are learning about God from them, we go out and we minister. Don't you know we are ministering to people who have been through trauma? Who have been through things that they don't understand how they can happen. So in this message, I want to talk about what trauma does to us. I want to talk about our high priest's empathy. It's right here in this passage that we read. And I want to talk about how his empathy draws us close to God and brings healing. Seems pretty heavy, but it's actually a feel-good message. It really is. I would trust that you would say that at the end. If you were to define trauma, you could say it is a deep, distressing, disturbing experience. It is emotional shock following a stressful event or a physical injury, which may be associated with physical shock or sometimes leads to long-term neurosis. It's a reaction, and everybody doesn't experience it the same way. It's profoundly injurious. It hurts a lot, right? And it occurs in the real world, this researcher, in a world in which we are routinely injured. Trauma, it shocks, it upheaves, it distresses, it stresses, it pains, it causes pain. It causes anguish. It's related to suffering. Words like upset and agony and misery and sorrow and grief and heartache and heartbreak and torture can be used. Think about the people that you know. Think about some of your children, some of our children, and some of the things that they have been through. Think about some of their friends. Think about the people who you come in contact with. What have they been through, and what has it done to them? Basil van der Kolk, a researcher who looks at what trauma has done to people, said that there are at least three different kind of realms of effect. One, trauma causes you to lose yourself. There's a loss of self. There is a reorganization of perception. And there's a numbing that happens. Now, I don't want to get too deep into all this. I'm going to have to go through, kind of getting a master's degree here. But the point is, I think he says some things important that we need to know. If we're going to be ministering to people, if you're going to be a friend to a person, if you're going to be around the person, if you're going to be in a family with a person in this world, understand what happens to them when trauma has an effect. Loss of self. Whether it's the result of something that you have done, something done to you or something you have done. How many people know that you can actually traumatize yourself? When you do something, you hurt yourself. Addiction hurts yourself. It hurts you. Some people can't stop hurting themselves. Whether it's done to you or whether you are doing it, it makes it difficult for you to engage in intimate relationships. After you've experienced something so unspeakable, he said, how do you learn to trust yourself or anyone else again? Or conversely, how can you surrender to an intimate relationship after you've been so brutally violated? If someone does something to you, especially injurious, rejection, abuse, or what happens to women when men take advantage of them, they take that into the future, and they don't know how to trust other people because they think the same thing that happened to them back then is going to happen again. Reorganization of perception. When people are compulsively and constantly pulled back into the past, that's what trauma does. It, like those memories I have of being in that house. If something happens, it takes me right back to that house, to that scene, the scene of the crime. They suffer from a failure of imagination, a loss of the mental flexibility that goes along with being able to creatively think about the future. Without imagination, there's no hope, no chance of envisioning a future. For most of us, a man coming down the street is just someone taking a walk. For a victim of rape, they may see a person who's about to molest her and go into a panic. For my student, who always reacted to everything that happened the same way, she went from 0 to 100 with her anger with everything. Everybody was a threat. Everybody was about to take advantage of her, and she needed to protect herself. And so before you got over on me, she said, I'm going to make sure. And I'm like, what is the problem? I really just thought black people was crazy. I really did. I really, really did. I really, really did. Especially women, but that's a whole other story. No. It's not that. It's that this girl has been messed over and she's protecting herself. She's automatically responding now. So it's like she couldn't help it. Anybody know anybody like this? Numbing. The researcher talks about veteran. A military personnel who had been through seeing too many things and being a part of too many things and then doing too many things himself. That's why the kind of research started with these folks. And he couldn't even feel anything anymore. He desperately wanted to love his family, says Richard, but he just couldn't because if you feel like you're going to feel something, then you feel like you're going to feel something that is hurtful, so you don't want to feel anything. Trauma results in a fundamental reorganization of the way the mind and brain manage perceptions, how we see the world. It changes not only how we think and what we think, but our very capacity to think. So when I said to myself at the scene of my students, I think folk are crazy, I was actually right. Because what trauma does is it changes the brain. It changes the way you're now. I won't get too deep into this, but let's just look at, yeah, we're already here, right? She's looking like you already went down that road. Look. This is your brain. This is your brain's, so you have two different kind of reactions to sensations. sensations, everything you feel out here, everything you're seeing, what's going on, it comes in, and it comes into the prefrontal cortex and the amygdala, right? So stress management, what is effective is you have a watchtower, which is the prefrontal cortex. That's the thinking part, that's the reasoning part, that's the part where you say, I'm going to control myself. That's why everything that happens to us, every little thing, we don't automatically punch everybody in the face. Because we can think about it and say, no, I probably shouldn't do that. That's probably not going to be good. Or if I want to, I'm going to do, well, I'm not going to your head. I'm not going to do that. You have some control, right? You observe, you take action, it's conscious choice. That's the part of the brain that's controlling that. But then there's a part of the brain that's the smoke detector that says danger. That says, something about to go down, I'm not going to respond, I'm not going to think about it, I'm just going to let it happen. Now, I'm not talking about sin, I'm talking about the way your brain reacts to survive. And I got to tell this story, my mother, very quickly. This kid punched my brother in the face when we were on our way home from Denny Street. I know you remember, I think I told this story before. We came up the block and the kids followed us home. My mother, you know how slim and all that she is, she's not these days, she don't lift weights and all that kind of stuff. We were coming up the block and this kid was chasing us home. Now after he punched him in the face, he's gonna chase us home. I mean, goodness gracious. We got in front of the house and the boy is crying. Of course, you know, I wasn't doing nothing. I was just kind of along for the ride. You know, I was too little to do anything. She immediately senses that something is wrong with her baby. The door flies open. She does not hit, you know, we had three steps, you know, the row house got some steps. She does not hit the steps. She comes off the top step, down through the air, to the curb. Do you understand what I'm trying to tell you? Because she says her baby was in trouble, she gonna do something. She had no shoes on. The child who hit my brother looked like this. Came off running at full speed. She chased that little rascal for a block and a half. That is an animistic response. That's the smoke detector. Something about to happen, I'm not thinking, I black out, and to survive, I make it happen. It just happens. The hormones in your body make your hair stand up, they make your heart pump faster, you get those that cortisone going, you get the cortisone going, the adrenaline starts, and now we're about to fight. It's on right now. That's just the way we're made. That's good. That's the way we're supposed to be made. When you're managing stress, sometimes, I'm going to say this, somebody needs to be on. I'm not saying anybody's going to punch somebody in the face. No, what I'm trying to tell you is sometimes you have to respond to survive. You get in the middle of the street, and you see a car coming. Let me think about whether I should move my foot. What I should decide to do is walk to the curb. No, you get yourself out the way, bro. Whoa! And before you know, you haven't thought about it. That's good. That helps us to survive. That's how we got here. The problem is, when you undergo an emotional stressful situation, when you undergo such intense fear or sadness or pain in a way that makes you, you overload the part of your brain that makes you respond with the automatic response. So you don't think. And if that happens, the part of your body, the part of your mind, the brain, the prefrontal cortex, it reduces your regulatory ability to control yourself, and all you do is you respond, you overcompensate, you just respond out of danger. Now what happens is, if the fear, the anxiety, the stress is intense enough, it will shrink the part of your brain that helps you to think, and it will magnify the part of your brain that helps you to respond in a way that you're overcompensating for danger, and that's how you start to react all the time. We call these people crazy. No. These people have been through something where you then one second they cool, oh, next second they're about to snap. Or they can't commit themselves to somebody else. Or they don't know how to love. Or they don't know how to really express their emotions. There's something going on. They're responding in a way that's automatic. And they can't help themselves. And if that happens time and time again, then you have a person who is living in constant trauma. Now, wait, let me just back it up. Ask your question. How many people know? How many people do you think, not that you know, how many people do you think living in this country have experienced something that, based on what we just talked about, we could say they have experienced trauma at some point in their lives? If we were to reduce this country to 10 people, and everybody's 10 people, how many people out of 10 people would you say have experienced trauma?
10.
I hear 10, I hear 9.
8.
Somebody says 6. Somebody said everybody. 5. How many people say 5? Okay, how many people say 6? How many people say 7, 8, or 9, or 10? Okay. So, research tells us that 7 out of these 10 people at some point in their life will have experienced something that we could call trauma. 70%. That's 70% of people walk around this country, that's 70% of people in this neighborhood. That's 70% of people that you know. That's 70% of people in this room. So I know my audience today. I know that you have experienced, I'm not just talking about people in the world, I'm talking about people in this room who have experienced something that we would say, I don't know if we know the color or care, but we would say it's been so injurious to us that it has done something to us. And we can unpack that. It probably takes a while to do that. But on an individual level, we at least 70. Now let me ask you another question. How many people living in the hood who live in situations of poverty, in inner city poverty in the United States, would you say would have experienced trauma? It's more than, in between 85 and 100%. 100%, let me say 100%. 100% of the people who live in a neighborhood, they go through situations of poverty. When you see violence in your neighborhood, it doesn't have to happen to you, understand? When you see it, when you feel it around the corner, when you know somebody who has died, but everybody knows somebody who has died, who has been close to them, that's everybody. And it's not just people who are addicted to drugs and who are out in gangs. I mean, it is people who wear suits just like me and you. It's people who go to church just like me and you. It's people in our classes and in our schools. Every single month of 2018, this country has witnessed what? A school shooting. Every single month. It's not limited to the hood. It's in the suburbs, it's the rich and the poor, it's everybody, because everybody is affected by sin.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
So we can get off what the doctors say and understand, listen, trauma is sin's effect on everybody.
Amen.
How many people, now let's bring it a little bit closer home. Which one of your children? Which one of your neighbors or friends, or which one of your classmates, or which one of your friends could ask this question? Where was God when I went through what I went through?
Yes, sir.
Amen.
If God, you can change the therefore in Hebrews 4, 16 to if we have such a high priest.
Yeah.
It is not therefore, it's if. If God is God, well, where? That's the unbeliever's question. I almost messed up. That's the believer's question as well. Guess what? There are many of us who are asking this question because the church tells us not to ask it. Because that question constitutes a lack of faith. But the biggest breakthrough I think I've had in a long time, I admitted to God, God, I am actually angry. I'm mad. If I was a fool, I would curse you. I'm not that stupid. I know that you love me, but I just don't understand. And I asked the W question. Yes, I asked, why me? Why I gotta be me? Because I know there are other people who didn't go through this, who are a little bit farther ahead. There's a little bit something different. They have a little bit more advantage. What disadvantages am I facing right now on the inside and in the circumstances of my life? Because I went through what I went through, and I asked God, what in the world was going on with this? I don't understand. And for the first time, I admitted, I was angry. Man, the writer to the Hebrews addresses everyone who would ask that question. Where was God when I went through what I went through? So, a little bit of background. The writer to the Hebrews is writing a letter to a church of persecuted Christians. He's writing to whoever it is, we don't know who it is. Some people think it's Paul. Some others don't. Persecuted Christians who were actually Jews, who converted from Judaism. And his purpose, his main purpose in writing the letter to them is to tell them, you either have to embrace Judaism as your way of understanding who God is and being close to God, or embrace Christ fully. If you're going to be Christians, embrace Christ. You can't have both. Because they were trying to continue in the Judaism. What were they trying to do? They were trying to continue in the ceremonial method of worship, and the religious method of worship, and all of the rituals. They're trying to keep all that stuff, and they were also trying to be Christians. Right? So the Hebrews said, you can't do that. You either have to accept Jesus, because the priests, he said, they made sacrifices. Jesus is the sacrifice.
Amen.
One or the other. And so we said to them, like the teacher of the religious law who came up to Jesus, the teacher, which is the greatest command? The man was being honest. He wanted to know how to follow what God was saying. That's where he was. What he wanted was to follow the law. And that's what he's telling these Jews he can't do. And he was also telling them, if you look at this picture here, the ceremonies, the rituals, what they would literally do as passed down from the Old Testament, to them from the Old Testament, carry out ceremonies year after year and day after day that would make them ceremonially clean. The writer to the Hebrews said, listen, you can be ceremonially clean, but guess what? You can't be clean on the inside.
All right.
So pick one. And so he says, the law can never, by sacrifices repeated endlessly year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. Day after day, he says, every priest stands and performs his religious duties. Again and again, he offers the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. The blood of goats and bulls and ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean sanctify them so that they are outwardly clean. Because literally, what was passed down to these Hebrew Christians was a way of being ceremonially clean. Yeah. The priest and the high priest, day after day and year after year, would make a sacrifice on their behalf so that they would be close to God. Right to the Hebrews saying, you can get clean on the outside.
Yeah.
Like this trash can. Uh-huh. Can everybody see this?
Yeah.
What I have here is a clean trash can. I know it's clean because I cleaned it. It was sitting in our garage. It's been sitting in our garage for weeks. But I cleaned it up and sat in here. It's clean on the outside. However, on the inside of this here trash can, what the writer to the Hebrews is trying to tell us is that everybody can do something religious.
All right.
70% of those people and 100% of those people can do something to clean up the outside of the trash can.
Okay.
And just like those Pharisees and Sadducees that Jesus said you can clean the outside, one of my favorite verses, but he was giving it to them, boy, he was doing, I can clean the outside of the cup. But the inside is full of wickedness and everything is fucking. You need to get yourself together. And y'all need to embrace me. Because you can clean the outside. This trash can is a wonderful trash can.
Uh-huh.
It locks. So that you can push the lid down so you can't smell what's on the inside. It also rodents can't get in it. Because we found, you know, that when we put our trash cans outside, I could have found out the rodents can eat through your plastic trash can. They would do that. They would take the lid off, get in your stuff, get their stuff, take the lid back on, put it back on, and then walk away. That's what raccoons would do. I'm trying to tell you. So I had to get this trash can that locks. See this thing right here? This right here, dude, locks it in. And guess what? We had put trash in here and left it in there for a couple weeks before we took it out to the curb so trash man could take it away. Come to find out, when you leave food in the trash can for a couple weeks and you open it up, you better have on a mask. Because this bad boy is empty and humming. So what I have in here today, and it locks good too. Jesus. Lord, I forgot my gloves. I'm not going to touch this. Oh, you know, I remember that meal. That was good. We got some oatmeal in here. We have some stuff that we ate about a week ago, some stuff we ate last night. It's terrible. You might want to get close to it. You are sure that right in here, I don't want to dump it out on nobody. We got some old pizza. The pizza scrap, that was good, right? That was a pretty good pizza, right? We had a pizza a week ago. And then we got kids. So when you have kids, you have to dispose of the equipment that they use to hold their boom boom and their boom boom. So we got some of that in there. You mix that up in there with all of that garbage. Now, what I could do is I could pack it away, wrap it up, put the lid on it, and I could lock it up. Lock it up and leave it there. Wouldn't smell it, wouldn't bother me. Then I can clean the outside. I can do some stuff to make this garbage be presentable. It would look good on our mantelpiece if I had a big enough mantelpiece for it. I could put some flowers around it, really spruce it up. Right? I can replace this label, put a nice little bow on there, make it look real beautiful. I can do a lot to it. But on the inside, it is full of garbage. Now we often think of the believer as one who has, through our belief, we have understood that there's a way to rid ourselves of our garbage. But I also wonder if there are those who believe in God, who trust and love and know God, who know His Word, who understand a lot about Him. But they've had things happen to them that are like putting in garbage. Dumping in garbage. And I wonder how long it has been since those who had the garbage in there can stand to ignore it and not take it out and spruce it up the outside. And I'm not indicting anybody, including myself, because nobody wants to deal. I don't even know how to deal with that stuff. That's the problem. The writer to the Hebrews comes along and he says, you can't handle it. You let this sit. I can let this sit here for years. You can open it up and probably blow up or something. I don't know. But the writer to the Hebrews says, the blood of goats and bulls and ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean, sanctify them so that they're outwardly clean. But verse 14, how much more then? Because I can clean this garbage can up. But how much more? How much more? How much better is it to really let the garbage on the inside get out of there? And the way that the writer to the Hebrews says that garbage gets out of there is you can't clean that garbage. You can't do anything. You can't take the garbage out yourself. You need a clean vessel. You need an unblemished. vessel. Jesus Christ offered himself unblemished to God. He had no garbage in him. He had done nothing wrong. He did nothing deserving wrong. He came down from heaven solely for the purpose of helping us to understand that as our high priest, he's not just interested in cleaning up the garbage. He's not just interested in cleaning up the outside of the can, I should say. But what he does, he says, you can take all your garbage and you can put it right in on the cross. On the cross. Jesus had the wrath of God poured out and into him. He was the only one who's been up into the heavens, the writer of John said, in his book. He was the only one who knew God, but the only one who knew God intimately and perfectly is the only one who came down and took all of it. And said, because you can't take it, I'm going to take it on me. You can't come to God with all this crap in you. Because you don't know how to. Now Jesus says, there's nothing stopping. The high priest, his job is to not just make us ceremonially clean, but clean for real. And the way that he does that, he says, verse 15, chapter 4, we don't have a high priest who is not able to empathize with our weaknesses. But we have a high priest who's been tempted in every way like we are, just as we are, yet he did not sin. And you can struggle with this verse and make it something that it's not, but it's very, very plain. What this says is Jesus, through the experience of understanding what the garbage is, because he experienced it. He's not a garbage man to take it and tell us to dump it up. He says, I'll take it on my eyes. Everything that we can experience, he experienced too.
Yes.
That's rejection. That's physical pain. That's emotional pain. That's everything that he can be tempted by. Now, some will call it blasphemous to say that Jesus was tempted. They made a movie about it, the temptation of Christ. I actually only watched part of it, but some people said, no, it wasn't really after tempted. Yes, this said the word, he was touched by the feeling of our infirmity, said the King James Version. That passage actually means that, listen, sympatheo. Sympatheo means he has the same feeling as. He's affected by the same feelings as another. He got into the same feelings we have. So if he asked, I'm sorry, if I asked, if you asked, where was God when I was going through, he asked the same question.
Yes.
Did he ever ask that question?
Yes.
My God, my God. Why have you forsaken me?
Yes.
You see Jesus on the cross, confused as I am and you are. You see him forlorn and forsaken just as we are. You see him as hurt as we are, and even more, because none of us have ever been on somebody's cross. So he took what we took, and it is, you can look at every, name one thing that you can go through that he has not been through. You say, well, I'm married. Man, God's dead. See, he ain't never been married. Yeah, well, guess what? The church is the bride of Christ. Right? So in the relationship with people, now my wife is here, so I don't want to get too deep into this, a whole other topic. We have a beautiful marriage. Ain't no more about marriage. We just, never had no problems. And some other marriages, though, I do know people do have disagreements. He went through with the people who were supposed to believe in him and accept him and support him and love him, and they rejected him, and eventually, as a matter of fact, they had him killed.
Yes.
There is nothing that we can go through that he has not felt.
Yes.
Amen.
And those feelings, the temptation that he experienced to react in a way that would not be godly, in a way that would be sinful. sin. He did not. There's the only difference. Is in his reactions, he didn't sin. But he felt everything. Temptation there, he's been tempted in every way. It means to test or to tempt. And the only way you can tell which one that word means is the context. So in some context, we are being tested. In other contexts, we're being tempted. He was both tested and tempted, and he never sinned in either one of those situations. But he knows exactly what it's like for us to be involved in prayer. So he comes close. And so when in a moment when you feel yourself overwhelmed by the stuff that you are still trying to work out, it is ultimately helpful for you to remember God, no matter whether it is me who has done it myself or someone who has done it to me, you have been right here in this moment. You feel what I feel. You know what I know. You understand. Nobody understands like you. And that draws the heart. If you could just rehearse that truth, if you could just remember, I know I'm going through right now, but God, you have experienced physical pain, emotional, psychological, everything that you can ever experience, he's been right, even financial, he's been right there. And in fact, even self-condemnation, right? 1 John said, if our hearts condemn us, Jesus knows our hearts, God knows our hearts, and he feels it much more. 1 John says, he understands what we don't even understand about ourselves. And so, in his experiencing what we experience, in his sympathy, and in his temptation without sin, he is taken in his sacrifice. All of the garbage that we would otherwise say.
Thank you, Lord.
And continue to be there. Continue to mess with that. So the writer to the Hebrews ends this chapter. And this is the feel good part, right? I thought it was solemn and thought provoking. It's actually a moment of celebration.
Yeah.
It's a moment of celebration. When you realize what you are going through, Jesus knows all the mess of it intimately. And when you understand he took that on himself, and when you understand you can live in that place where you constantly rehearse the gospel to yourself, and when you understand that he is tempted in every way like we are, and when you understand that the reason that he did that is to give us the ability to come to God, you can run and skip and leap and jump and shout and come boldly to the throne of grace. There's no holding back. I've discovered I haven't been given, we sung that song, I give him all of me. I haven't been giving him all of me. You know why? Because I've been afraid to tell him exactly all of my mess, exactly all of my dirt. I can tell him absolutely anything. I can share in this relationship anything. He can handle it all. He can handle all the mess. I can put it all on him. I can come boldly. There's nothing that holds me back. Because that mess before, it kept me holding like, no, God. No, let me stay over here. I'm still, you know, be clean and everything. But that's just enough. No. This means come. 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 Bring it all. I can handle all. come here. Be with me right here. The word, when I actually understood what the word meant, it blew my mind. It doesn't just mean boldly, doesn't just mean confidently. It's associated with change. It means, it implies that there's some results of being changed that enables you to do something. I can come because of what he already did.
Yes, yes.
Not because of what I have to do, but because of what he, if you ever, my purpose in this message is, I think, the exact same purpose as the writer to the Hebrews. If you ever in your life from here, now, on after, think there's any dirt in you, if you are a believer, if you are in Christ today, he took all of the dirt, all of the shame, all of the garbage, all of the weight, all of the pain, and he put it on himself. There's no residue left. You're not a second-class citizen. You're not a second-class Christian. You don't need no more Holy Spirit. You don't need no more Jesus, no more God. You've been made perfect in him. And all you got to do is present your nasty, filthy garbage to yourself, to God, and he will accept you for who you are and love you like your child. So just come. Don't worry about serving him. Just come. Don't worry about how much scripture, how perfect you are. Don't worry about what you feel like. Just come. Just come. Boldly. Come on in here. Come on. Assuming that there are others who feel the same way as me. I'm taking a chance. But if what we all know is right, there's some residue that we keep thinking is still left in there that prevents us from coming bold. And whatever that means to you. So I'm going to take another chance. This is our moment. Now, I'm not making anything of this particular set of stairs. It's just wood with carpet over. But Jesus says, through the writing to the Hebrews, you can come to me boldly, to the throne of grace, and find help in your time of need, knowing that in the future there's something that's going to keep you from coming boldly. And he said, no, don't let it be so. If there is anything in you who I'm talking to, that you feel would prohibit you from your bold approach to the throne, I want you to come. I want you to come. I want you to come. Come. And I'm really not trying to work us up emotionally so that we answer my altar call. I want to invite you to come. And please realize, this doesn't just happen here. This happens every single day of our lives as Christians. In our Christian experience, you have to persevere. We have to persevere. And keep on coming. 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 When you think about other people that we know, I'm actually not really dealing with that right now. This is really about us right where we are right now. This is about me right where I am right now. And I know for myself, there's been times when I've allowed what has happened to me to keep me from a deeper experience of who I can be in God. I've questioned when I could have been celebrated. I want to come more easily, more quickly, more confidently. God, shower us, rain down on us your confidence. Cleanse us from the inside out. God, let us know that there's nothing that prevents us from coming to you. on and come. Just come on and come. Just come. When you think about it, just come on and come. Ignore what your mind tells you. Just come on and come. You know what that means for you. You have to come. Boldly. Because they're the only place that we find mercy.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
In our time. Father, we thank you for this wonderful experience we've had. We thank you for the man of God who has heard from heaven and has been able to come and so clearly represent your word to us so that we can see that we may be messed up on the inside and that we may still have some garbage on the inside. And we may be dressed nicely and we may have clothed ourselves in outer garments that look as though we are whole. But we know that we have had trauma in our lives. We know that we've had a mess in our lives. We've had stuff that sometimes we go back and we mull over again and it comes back just as vividly as it was when it first happened. That we're still suffering sometimes from the past. But Lord, thanks be to God that today we've been shown the light, that we now have a great high priest. So great a high priest. That he does not clean us on the outside, but he cleans us on the inside. Thank you, Lord, for your cleansing power, where you can go right inside and make us anew, where we become what you've called us to be, where we become like you, because we become clothed in you. We become clothed in righteousness. But it's all because of the cross. It's all because of Jesus. It's all because of this great high priest. And Lord, as our speaker today encourages us, we have to make a choice. Are we going to serve Jesus or are we going to serve religion? Are we going to serve the one true God, or are we going to find a way to look like we are serving God? Those that are standing before you today, Lord, you have revealed to us truths that are in us and maybe hurts that are in us, but Lord, you've also revealed to us that you are the answer, and that you are the one who can clean us up. So Lord, as we stand before you, we say to you, have your way, Lord. Have your way. The old song says, make us and mold us. Take all that we have as we give it all to you and make us into new people, into new creation. Clean us up, Lord. And now we are ready for service for you. So Lord, as we have come and confessed our sins, as we have come and said that you can have all of us, now there's work for us. Use us, Lord, after your will, to bring glory to your name. We thank you. We praise you, Lord, for our preacher says this is a good feeling time. We have a high priest, so now we can come boldly. Now we can not be hesitant. Now we cannot be afraid, because you have given us freedom. Thank you for the freedom, Lord. And you said, who the Son has set free is free indeed. Praise your name, Lord. Praise your name, Lord.